Welcome to the Cerebral Entertainment Podcast. Let's unhook from the Matrix and start thinking for ourselves.
Hey, look, the Cerebral Entertainment Podcast is all about critical thinking. It's about unhooking from the Matrix, stop listening to the mainstream media, and start thinking for yourselves. And hopefully, be a little entertained at the same time. You big stupid.
Sometimes life's not fair. I correct myself. I mean, all the time. I feel like complaining, but it only bothers you.
Yeah, so, Colt, it's been a crazy year. 2016. You know, I've seen so many Facebook post and Twitter tweets and just word of mouth of people just fomenting about how terrible 2016 was for them. And my 2016 wasn't really that bad. It could have been better, could have been worse, I guess, but it was kind of run of the mill. It was okay. You know, we did okay in 2016. How about you?
I'm the same way. I feel like a lot of the things that happened that everybody is considering terrible, I agree, there are a lot of terrible things that happened in 2016. But the things that actually affected my personal life, I mean, yeah, I have bad feelings for those things, but that actually affected me in my personal life. I don't see that it was that terrible of a year compared to any other year.
Yeah. Of course, I do have to mention that I did lose my grandfather this year, okay. and my wife lost her grandfather. They were both 93 years old,
right?
You know, so it's still tough. Anytime you have to lose somebody, they could be, you know, 127, and it would still suck because you're going to miss them. But knowing that they were 93, had full lives, you know, and they were ready. It's cliche-ish, but they were ready.
And it's almost a comfortable feeling when somebody gets to that kind of an age when they pass away, because like you said, they lived a full life.
Yeah,
you know, it's when people are a lot younger than that you really have a lot more emotion towards it, I guess, if that's what you want to say.
Absolutely, that's when you hear the other cliche, they were so young, or they were way too young to die, and things like that. And it does suck, of course. But, yeah, so aside from that, though, personally, I was doing okay this year, you know. No complaints, really, whatsoever. But as a nation, you know, as a world, across the world, in our culture and just across the board, there have been some pretty crazy happenings, goings-ons with 2016. And so I just want to discuss some of those things with you. I know you've got some points that you'd like to bring up, and I'd definitely like to hear those points.
I have a lot of points, to be honest with you, that I really want to hit on. So my first topic is going to be social justice warriors.
SJW in the house.
Yes, sir. I'm really curious on where you stand with social justice warriors. That's what I kind of figured I'd get as a reaction.
Yeah. Does my sigh illuminate my feelings at all there? Because
not enough, though. I think you can explain in depth.
Okay, so social justice warriors. Look, we have a history is rife with social injustices, right? It happens all the time. It always has. It's not a new phenomenon by any stretch of the imagination. So there has always been a need for people to step up and speak out and to work against injustices in the world. Okay, I have no argument with that. But let's talk about what I've seen this year as far as these so-called social justice warriors are concerned. I've seen people at Donald Trump rallies, their kids is what they are, look like 19, 20-year-old kids, blocking the entrances to rallies. And they just stand there as if they're doing no harm. And when people try to pass, they're like, quit assaulting me. Get your hands off of me, you know. They're such wussies, you know. That's not a warrior. That is, they're pawns, you know. They're being played, they're being manipulated by puppet masters. You know, that's a whole other topic there. If you want to go down the George Soros route or the, you know, the Hillary Clinton route or whatever, you know, they're people.
Regardless, they're being played by somebody who's manipulating them to
do these things, you know. And so it, a lot of it's starting in college campuses, and they've got all these safe spaces. You've heard about the safe spaces, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And I didn't even realize for a long time. I kept hearing about the safety pin thing. When someone's wearing a safety pin on their clothing, that means that they are needing a safe environment. And so you can't speak about anything that might be a little bit controversial in front of them, or else they're going to freak out and have a conniption and start crying, you know, about the injustice that's being done.
And you're probably going to get sued for it.
In this climate, that's a very good possibility. And so those are just a couple of the examples that I've seen from social justice warriors. Look, like I said, there's a lot of injustice in the world. These things need to be dealt with. But the way it's being dealt with and some of the things that they're trying to deal with is just ridiculous. It's ridiculous. They shouldn't be doing what they're doing, period.
And I think the majority of it, I know you're talking about blocking lines for Trump rallies and all this other stuff, but I think the majority of this social justice warrior age we're in right now is internet. I think it's majority of it is social media, and I think it's everybody hiding behind a computer for what they are believing, and I don't get it. I really don't.
Yeah, and I have seen, you know, for people who are fighting for tolerance, they are some of the most intolerant
little people that I've ever seen in my life.
You know, they are tolerant, and they stress tolerant as long as it's on issues that they agree with or that they're aligned with. If it's something they're not aligned with or people that they are not aligned with, then they are the most intolerant people that are out there right now. You know, they are the most bigoted, sometimes racist, anything you can think of, all those ists and isms that are out there. They don't have a clue. They don't have a clue. They're just being led by their noses, basically. And it's a culture. You're right about social media. That's a big part of it. That's how it's being so widely disseminated, you know, to everybody, because all these kids have laptops in front of them and they're on Facebook and they get lured in by, you know, different websites and things like that. But it's also, you know, like I said, in schools and college campuses, they're being indoctrinated in large part to a liberal leftist. And you can't even really say liberal. These people truly aren't liberal. There's nothing about liberty about these people. They want it their way, and if you don't give it to them, they're gonna cry and they're gonna sue, and they're gonna come at you with everything they got. And it's kind of like a mafia, man. They're using mafia tactics.
It's insanity to me, and yeah. Insanity. And you know, I just don't understand how we are where we're at in this sense compared to where we were 10, 15, 20 years ago. We are so wussified to this point in our life that it's scary to think of the world that our kids are going to grow up in.
Yeah, it's the pendulum swing, man.
The pendulum was so far right, you know, 30, 40 years ago, whatever, 50 years ago, maybe 60, I don't know, whatever. Before the 60s, you know, and when the 60s came around, it started this pendulum swing to the other way. And it's never stopped. It's just kept going and going and going. You know, you had the hippies and the free love, and then the druggy 70s and the 80s, which were just, I don't know what the 80s were. They were just weird. And then you had the 90s, which I loved the 90s for the most part. I thought the 90s were good, but that pendulum just kept swinging. And now you've got what you've got, man. You've got these kids and these misinformed people who, they're just not realistic. You know, they have an idea, and for one thing, the idea is unrealistic, but it's also just crazy. I mean, what are you looking for? You know, it seems like they want robots. They want people to conform to them, and if you don't, then you are the enemy. So,
yeah, but it's also a matter of everybody has their different opinions as well. So, like we talked before, you're never going to please everybody. Mm-hmm. So it's almost like you got to choose your own what direction you want to go in,
and you're going to piss somebody off, and you're going to make somebody happy no matter what direction you decide to go in.
Yeah, that's a great point, because we should at least be able to respect each other's opinions. And to me, that's what a social justice warrior should be about, is an open forum for opinions. And that's just not the case. And so that's where part of my motivation to do what we're doing here, and a lot of what I'm trying to brand, what I'm all about, is critical thinking and an open forum for different ideas. Whether you love them or hate them, let's listen to each other, you know, without, you know, putting your finger in your ear and going, la, 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 I can't hear you. Because that's basically what they're doing. If you don't agree with them, then you're wrong, period. And they won't even listen to another side of the story. So
I agree.
What do you got next?
Black lives matter, cops lives matter.
Oh, yes. Which, you know, I don't know if the Black Lives Matter started this year. Did it start in 2016? I believe it started.
It may have been 15.
Yeah.
But some of the stuff that I'm coming up with, most of it was from 2016, but some of it started in the year before.
Gotcha.
But really branched out
this
last year, and if it was a big topic, I really wanted to hit on it.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, it's absolutely a big topic, and no matter when it started, it was still huge in 2016, regardless. So I've been kind of, my trajectory has kind of changed a little bit, I guess, my perspective a little bit on the Black Lives Matter movement. When I heard someone say, look, because you saw all these spinoffs like All Lives Matter and Blue Lives Matter, you know, Yellow Lives Matter, whatever. But I heard someone say, look, we know that all lives matter. What we're trying to do is illuminate the idea that Black lives matter too, because that's the way that we feel, as if we don't matter. Okay. And I got to thinking about that. I'm like, you know what? That's a pretty profound statement there. It's not about saying that nobody else's lives matter. It's about stating the fact that, hey, we feel like we're being looked over. We feel like that we're being mistreated, and that we're misrepresented in our culture, in our society. And so, therefore, we want to highlight the fact that, hey, we're here, you know, and we're not just here for, we're not just out here committing crimes and so on and so forth for cops to shoot at us. We're people. And so that really illuminated, it kind of changed me a little bit. Having said that, the protests where they walk up the highway in St. Louis in block traffic, and other cities too, is ridiculous. You know, the whole point of picketing and even rioting is to get attention. It's to bring attention to a subject. But, man, some of the ways they do it, it just infuriates me, because I don't know, maybe I just don't get it.
Well, do you think there was a certain instance that this whole Black Lives Matter movement came from? I feel like the first one that hit big with us was like what you're talking about, the whole Ferguson thing. I can't remember right now.
Michael Brown.
Okay.
That's exactly where Black Lives started.
Okay. So you've got that, and then you've got the other story, and this is, I should have researched this, but I didn't. Who's the other, the black guy who was selling cigarettes and the cop choked him out on the sidewalk?
Yeah, I don't remember his name. That was up in New York, though.
But I think that was a big part of this, where this started too.
Yeah, it was, because that happened not too long after the Michael Brown incident.
Right.
And then more recently, I don't remember how long ago it was, but you also had the shooting in Michigan, and you also had one down in Louisiana, just really close to each other. One of them, the guy was in the car, and the cop shot him while his girlfriend was sitting there recording the whole time with her phone as she was sitting there in the driver's seat. And the cop
shot the African-American guy in the passenger seat. Got the whole thing on camera.
And he died right there. And then the other guy was out. He was selling something in front of
a gas station. And the cops
got down and then had him down on the ground at some point in time. Also, there was a couple in a car who were recording it with their phone. And all of a sudden you hear shots. And then they start kind of flipping out and trying to move away because they don't want to get shot too.
Well, because I remember where it really hit with me on that part, or on that whole thing, was I remember it was not too long after that incident that you just talked about, when I think it was like Kobe Bryant and the Lakers and stuff started wearing out on their overshirts over their jerseys when they came out. I think they said Black Lives Matter, didn't they? Is that what they said? It was something to that effect.
Yeah, something to that effect.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so, That brought up another controversy, because I think it was, I don't remember if it was the basketball players or the football players, but the football players could wear Black Lives Matter, you know, something or the other on their uniforms, a little insignia or a little Black Lives Matter label or something somewhere, but they couldn't wear something about the cops that were shot in Dallas that time. That also happened in 2016, where there was a sniper, and the guy was taking out cops who were actually protecting the people and the community while there were protesters out there.
Right.
And he took it upon himself to snipe some of those guys during that protest, some of the cops. And so that was another controversy, because it was like some free speech is protected. Now, mind you, that we're talking about a private franchise here in the NFL. But they didn't mind this free speech, but this other free speech that was regarding cops was not allowed, and they were going to get fined if they did that.
Right.
And then I don't know if you have it on your list, but it seems natural to just to move on to Colin Kaepernick.
I think I have it on the list too, talking about him sitting for the national anthem.
Yeah.
I think everybody's got a different opinion on this thing. And honestly, I think this has turned racial in part. I think a lot of your African-American people are going to say he's justified for what he's doing, because he doesn't want to stand for a national anthem that stands for a country that justifies what's going on. And it goes back to the Black Lives Matter thing and all that, you know. And there's a lot of people that have followed behind him that have done the same thing. In my opinion, you're still in this country. You still live in this country. It's not affected you personally. I don't think he's justified by what he's doing. What do you think?
Well, you hit the nail right on the head when you said it doesn't affect somebody personally. Because I'll be honest with you, I agree with you. But at the same time, what Colin Kaepernick did doesn't affect me personally either.
Right.
And it doesn't, you know, at first, I guess my knee-jerk reaction was that I was kind of offended, you know, by him not standing. Who doesn't stand for the national anthem, especially when you're a professional sports, you know, player and you are quote-unquote role model, so on and so forth. And it's just like he was perpetuating anger that I would prefer that we all come together and talk about this now. I think we're at a point in culture where we could actually have a pretty good conversation if people would shut up and open their minds and stop, you know, start listening and just stop, you know, stop throwing stones at each other.
Well, it's just a matter of, like I said, I don't necessarily agree with what he's doing, but I also look at it as him, like you said, him sitting during the national anthem affects nobody,
right,
whatsoever. So for it to be a huge injustice and be a huge issue
because one person who is maybe the worst quarterback in the NFL right now sat during the national anthem or stood on his knee or, you know, got down on a knee during the national anthem.
Yeah, big freaking deal.
So what, why is it such an outrage? Now, I get it because people think that he's not not being for this country or
unpatriotic.
He's being unpatriotic, and I get that. However, we're all as divided as a country we are right now anyways. The best thing to do would be to accept everybody's differences, and if you don't have the same beliefs as somebody else, that's fine. Just accept it and move on.
Right.
There's no reason that this should be as big of a deal as it is.
I agree, and my biggest beef of the whole thing, which really wasn't a beef at all, to be honest with you, not in the grand scheme of things, but because I don't care what his opinion is, you know, okay, I hear you, I see it. It made me think about it, so, you know, point taken, okay? So in that sense, it was successful. But my bigger beef was with the NFL for their, you know, their duplicity, I guess, you know, for their kind of hypocrisy when they allow one form of free speech that's, you know, disrespectful to a segment of the population versus another form of free speech with it, which is, you know, disrespectful to another segment, because they shut one down, they let one go. And so I what I did, I quit watching football, you know, and it's not like I'm carrying a chip on my shoulder about it. Football is too big anyway. I think people, you know, I enjoy the game, I enjoy the sport, I like watching it, But it's not so big of a deal to me that I'm going to keep watching it if it's going to cause any kind of frustration within me. It was very easy for me. I may have watched literally maybe two games this year. I've kind of, you know, been channel surfing and checked scores here and there and then moved on. But I don't sit down and watch football this year. And it's not so much just because I'm so flabbergasted by Colin Kaepernick's behavior that I just, you know, I can't tolerate this. And so I must be intolerant because of my lack of tolerance.
It's because you're upset that the Rams decided to go to L.A. to be terrible.
You know, yeah, right. I'm just upset because they wouldn't give Jeff Fisher one more loss to break the record. That, man, I hate that.
They really should have.
I know, one more loss, and they lost the next week. He could have held the record. I would have loved that. But no, it's that, you know what, I've got more important things that I want to, you know, use my thinker for. I want to critically think about other things. Okay, the Colin Kaepernick thing happened, the NFL thing happened. I assessed it, I formulated my opinion, and then I moved on because it's tired now. I don't care for it. So
right.
Bring on 2017, and yeah. So, yeah. What else you got?
Oh, see what we want to go to. So I've got kind of this list that I've got is kind of the ups and the downs of 2016. So we've got bad things and good things. The Black Lives Matter thing, you can decide what you want
to
consider it.
It's up
depending
to you.
On your own opinion, you know, mm-hmm. just like what we're trying to get with this podcast, trying to broaden your horizons and make you think for yourself, basically.
That's right.
So let's move on to the Harambe situation with the boy who fell in the cage at the zoo with the gorilla.
Harambe.
Yeah.
Oh man, I've seen so many posts, so many
post-mortem since Harambe left this earth. Okay, so remind me of the story. So a kid falls into the gorilla pit.
Correct.
At the zoo.
Yeah.
It's my understanding that the parents were leaning him over there or something, or did he just climb in?
From what I've understood, it's just a matter of the kid got away, or not really got away, but just it's one of those situations where anybody can say it's a parent's fault because the parent should have been keeping track of their kid. But I don't have kids of my own, but I also know that from watching Friends with Kids, anything like that, kids can get away in 2 seconds. From you having your head look the other way.
Right.
So I'm not blame. I don't know who to blame. I don't know if there is a blame. However, the kid did get into the pit, got into it with the gorilla, and the gorilla was shot instantly, and there was huge outrage on this situation. It was divided because some people say that the gorilla wouldn't have hurt the kid, because it would have treated the kid as one of its own, basically, or a baby. But I think they reacted the way they did to the gorilla because they didn't want to take the chance on what would happen.
So to me, this points back to the state of our culture, of our society, okay? I like gorillas, okay, right? You know, but I've watched enough Nat Geo to know that given a chance, a gorilla is going to rip the head off of a grown man, much less a little kid.
Right.
And if it's between my kid and a gorilla, I'm shooting that gorilla in a heartbeat. I'll fillet that gorilla. I'll eat its heart. You know, I will drink its blood and bathe in its internal organs.
You seem hungry.
Well, the point is, people are, you know, we want to save the trees, but we want to argue about whether or not, you know, a child is worth shooting this gorilla over, taking that chance. You know, maybe Harambe wouldn't have hurt that kid. Maybe, you know, maybe. But who's taking that chance?
Well, but it's the same. It's the issue of it would be the complete opposite situation if they wouldn't have shot the gorilla, let it do what it's going to do, and then it killed the baby. Then everybody's going to complain that they didn't kill the gorilla.
True.
So there's no, you can't win for losing in this situation. There's no way.
I think we just like to argue about things as a society.
That's where we're at these days.
You know.
Yeah.
Another first world solution, you know. So we're pretty bored because we're surviving okay for the most part, a lot of us. And you know, we got things going pretty good, so we need stuff to argue about. Let's argue about this big monkey who, you know, found a kid and then got shot. So what do you got next?
All right. So do you want to hit the election now, or do you want to wait a little bit after a couple more topics?
Hey, now's perfect. Why not?
If we're gonna, if so, this I would imagine you agree. This would be the biggest topic we've got as far as 2016 goes.
Yeah, I think so by far. I mean, it's a matter of opinion, but first of all, you know, let's go back a little bit. I think the biggest story for me was the wiping the floor with all the other Republican candidates by Donald Trump in the primaries. To me, that's a bigger story than the general election where he beat Hillary Clinton in the Electoral College. Because Donald Trump, he mopped the floor up with every Republican that was up on that platform.
Right.
Just wiped them out, you know. And to me, that was a bigger referendum from the people than once again, him beating Hillary in the general election. But
I agree.
It was a referendum on change. People, specifically the Republican Party, was sick and tired of business as usual. They're sick and tired of these robots like Jeb Bush and like Ted Cruz spouting off the same old stuff. And you can see the soulless, you know, corporate-minded degradation in their eyes, right? It's become so obvious that, man, these people, it's the same old, regurgitated crap that we're used to.
And people were willing
to take a chance on this wild card, Donald Trump, just to get something different. It was worth a shot. It was worth a chance. And I'll be honest with you, you know, I talked to you earlier about the Young Turks. You know, they're very liberal-leaning, but I think they're some of the most fair liberal-leaning podcast hosts that I know of. He actually came to that same conclusion just not too long ago, way after I did. But it's good to hear that from the left side, that they realize that
people were willing to take such a chance on a wild card just because they want something different.
And we have talked off air about this before, several times, in fact. But I agree. I think that just because of how things have gone over the past however many years you want to go back, I think that everybody knows that if Hillary would have gotten office, it would have been business as usual and nothing would have changed. I think that bringing in Trump, nobody knows what's going to happen. They don't know how things are going to play out whatsoever. Whether it be 4 years, if he gets another term, whatever. Nobody knows what's going to play out. But I think that everybody was willing to take the wild card, like you said, and just they're more worried about things staying the same than they are things changing. And they know things are going to change with Trump, whether that be bad or good. Nobody knows. But they're willing to take the chance just so it changes.
Exactly. That's exactly right. It's just that time. I mean, it's bound to happen at some point in time. At least you got to hope so, because it's been going down the tubes for so long. Not that it won't go down the tubes now. Time will tell. But I mean, I got to admit, I was excited about the prospect of what's this guy gonna do, man.
Right.
You know, but what was even just as interesting, if not more interesting, was the division that this election caused in the people of the United States and even around the world to some degree. But I have never seen a presidential election where people were so angry.
It was insane.
At one side or the other, just because of a presidential candidate. I mean, you're talking about riots and mass protesting and death threats and insults and ridicule and, you know, mudslinging, you name it. It was on. This presidential election brought some foment out of people that I didn't know that a presidential election could really bring. You know.
Yeah, I think you've hit it right on the head. I don't think we've ever seen anything like this election. I really don't.
Yeah, you have some of these movie stars who had threatened to leave the country before he got elected, and so obviously that was, you know, BS. And I wonder if they really thought that because they have such a big ego that they thought they would change somebody's mind. Well, I don't want to vote for him because then Rosie O'Donnell will leave the country, and we can't have that, so let's vote for Hillary or not vote at all for Trump.
Well, we've seen how that worked out.
Right, yeah. And so where are they going? They're not going anywhere.
Right.
You know, Ray's not coming home. That's not going to happen. They are going to stay right where they're at, and they're just going to keep complaining. But they're crazy because it's going to actually boost their ratings, you know, like on shows like The View or some of these other actors and people. I mean, they're having, I don't know if you heard about this, they're actually, because of the Trump inauguration, you know, there was some controversy about bands not wanting to play for that because they, you know, disagree with Trump, you know, and plus aside from that, their fan base, you know, just has pure hatred for Trump. So he had trouble getting some acts to play at his inauguration. Well, he got some. I mean, I think there were plenty out there that would agree. One of those that disagreed was Elton John. I'd be like, oh, you know, sorry, you know, right. Elton John can't make it, right? That's a big, you know, kick in the butt. But so what the Democrats are doing now, they're having their own concert down, I believe it's in Miami. So they're gonna have one that rivals the inauguration. So this is pretty unprecedented here. They're gonna have their own show just to show that, hey, we can bring these bands that rejected Trump and they're gonna come play for us. We're gonna have our own.
That's ridiculous.
If we're gonna take our own ball, you know, you can't play with our ball. We're gonna take it over here and play in Florida. So you can't play with us. It's ridiculous, man. And this is what it was interesting though. All the things we're talking about, some of it negative, some of it positive, but you gotta admit it's all been very interesting.
I'll give you that one. That's for sure.
Yeah. So let's not tire this subject out too much. What else you got?
Let's bring it down a little bit. This year has been full of major deaths. Big name deaths. I got a small list here. Let's go with David Bowie.
Yeah.
We got Prince.
Right.
We got China, the wrestler.
Mm-hmm.
We got Kimbo Slice.
Oh yeah.
Arnold Palmer, world famous golfer.
Oh, absolutely.
Florence Henderson, maybe the most beloved TV mom ever.
The Brady mom.
Right. And Muhammad Ali.
Yeah. Yeah. Muhammad Ali. He was one that suffered for a long time.
He really did.
Yeah, he had a rough time leading up to his death. David Bowie, you know, I never was really a big David Bowie fan. He had a couple of songs that I like.
What was his big one? White Wedding? Sorry, but David Bowie?
No, that's Billy Idol.
Oh, I was completely wrong then. My bad.
You're way off.
You know how old I am compared to you? Come on.
No.
What was David Bowie's big song?
Let me look. But I my favorite was one called I'm Afraid of Americans. And when I like David Bowie, it's called I'm Afraid of Americans. But I like David Bowie when he got with Trent Reznor from the Nine Inch Nails.
Okay.
That just showed his, he was able to do a lot of different things because David Bowie music in the past was cutting edge for the time, but he really wasn't. I didn't think he was all that great. So he had songs like Under Pressure, which that's a familiar one.
Okay, yeah, that song.
With,
I know
with
that
Prince,
one. Yes.
Or not Prince. I'm sorry, with Queen.
Yes,
Queen. You had Space Oddity, and we're going all the way back to 1969 here, right? You've got Let's Dance, right? Heroes, Life on Mars, Starman, Rebel Rebel, Modern Love, China Girl. I actually know that one a little bit, right? Because most of these I don't. Here's one that's familiar, Changes. You remember the song Changes?
Yes, I do.
That's David Bowie. And so David Bowie was kind of your, underground a little bit. He wasn't like super popular. He had a niche. You know, he had a particular following. He was a weird guy, let's be honest. He was just weird. And so, yeah. Sorry to see him go. He died pretty young. I think he was only like 69, maybe, something like that.
I'm not sure of the age. I didn't look, to be honest with you.
So, yeah, he pretty young, though, still. So who else did you have there? You had...
Prince.
Okay, Prince. This guy was absolutely amazing. You know,
you had Purple Rain, Diamonds and Pearls.
He had a lot of really good songs, not necessarily my style. When Doves Cry, you know, was all right, I guess. But this guy was absolutely amazingly talented. He was somewhat of a musical prodigy at a very young age. He could play every instrument you put in front of him.
I'm pretty sure it was the Purple Rain album, maybe, that he played every instrument during the recording of that album.
Okay.
I'll look it up just to be sure. But the guy was pretty amazing, and he was one of those, you know, kind of like just an all-around performer, I guess. So yeah, very talented, but also in my opinion very niche. He was very weird because both these guys, I mean, they're very effeminate, both of these two, you know, very effeminate guys. They weren't your masculine type of, you know, construction worker type of, you
for
know,
sure,
right. But
you can't forget all the stories that Dave Chappelle had about Prince.
What were
Oh, come on.
What were the songs?
You never seen Dave Chappelle?
Of course I've seen Dave Chappelle, but what did he have about Prince?
You never seen the episodes of Prince playing basketball?
Yeah,
and with Charlie Murphy,
yes,
and
yes,
all that?
Well, because I kept thinking about the Rick James episode. That's the one
gotcha
that really sticks out in my mind.
I gotcha.
No, he was only, Prince was only 57. I don't know how old David Bowie was. Prince was only 57.
Did they ever come out with a for sure reason of
cause
death for him?
Cause of death? I think it was heart failure, which is typically just another way of saying that he was on too many drugs at the time, or that he had taken so many drugs over the course of his life that his heart probably gave out.
It seems like, especially with big names, that the
words heart failure pretty much just means your heart stopped and there was a reason for that, but
you're
they
right
don't give you what the reason was.
But we don't want to talk about that.
Right.
Yeah. And so did Scott Weiland not die this year too?
You know what? He may have.
Or was that last year? Might have been toward the end of last year.
I don't know for sure. It affected 2016 no matter what.
It still affects me. Yeah, it's going to affect me for a long time. But this says Prince is said to have played every single instrument, 27 in all.
Wow.
So, I mean, he could pick up like a French horn probably and just start jamming on it, right?
Wow.
So, yeah, the guy was amazingly talented. China was the wrestler.
Yeah.
Female wrestler. I assume that she was good. I'm not a wrestling fan, but I know that name, so she has name recognition.
She was more of a guy wrestler than anything. She was a very muscular woman. But she made a pretty big impact for the time that she was in. But I think she had a lot of issues with pills and things like that later on in life.
Okay. So you're big into bodybuilding and things like that. What's your take on female bodybuilders? When is it too far, you know?
Are we talking bodybuilders or are we talking... Because bodybuilding has a lot of different classes. If we're talking bodybuilding in general, I don't... I think whatever makes you happy makes you happy. But I think it's also kind of what we think or we talk about on this podcast is that you kind of have to take in what you like, but don't discourage what you don't, if that makes any sense. You know, if there are women out there who love bodybuilding, they love lifting weights, and there are women out there that could lift crazy amounts more than I can. And that's fine with me. That's not necessarily what I look for or what I want in a woman, but I don't downgrade them or discourage them from doing what they're doing because that's what they want to do.
I got you. I just don't think that there can't be very many people out there that want that in a woman by some of the ones I mean, I'm talking about the big, like,
there. I mean,
super
you'd
buff.
Be surprised.
Oh, wow.
Anyway, what's next on our list?
Let's go with Cubs win the World Series.
Wow. Cubs win the World Series. What has it been, 108 years since their last World Series? Is that right? Maybe it's 110, something like that. But
it's pretty close, but the main thing that drives me the most insane is the fact that it's our rivals that wins the World Series this year.
Yeah, but I mean, think about it. Our rivals they won their first World Series in over 100 years.
That's very true. I mean, I give them props and give them the respect for winning it.
I mean,
still not happy about it.
The dog shines, the sun shines on a dog's butt every now and again, right?
That's very true.
It hasn't shined on that dog's butt for over 100 years. I'd say, you know, more power to them, but it's still very historical. You know, at some point in time after I knew that the Cardinals weren't in it anymore, that I was rooting for the Cubs, you know, because it's history. It's history, straight up.
It really is.
Yeah. What else we got?
Pokemon Go.
Oh, my gosh. Pokemon Go. This...
Did you ever download this thing?
I never downloaded Pokemon Go.
I didn't. I refused to.
I mean, there are very few things in pop culture, you know, that really irk me, you know, because usually I can just be like, you know, whatever, it's not my thing. Okay, I'm just going to go over here and do my thing. You go run out in the street and look for, you know, whatever, Pokemons. But Pokemons, this game irked me. it was so pervasive. It was everywhere. It was everywhere you looked, everywhere, you know, social media, on the news. It was everywhere, you know. And then I would see people, these zombie people looking at their phone, and they would find Pokemon, I guess, on their phone. They had to be there actually geographically.
It's something like that. It's like gems or something that you can get on the game that are at certain locations, because it's all through like your GPS.
Yeah.
So you, I actually it summed up 2016 to me completely, because I watched like a 16-year-old kid walking up the sidewalk in, around our area, looking at his phone. I knew he was playing Pokemon Go while he was vaping. And I'm like, this is 2016, 100%.
That's right. That completely just framed the day that we live in today.
Yep.
Wow. Yeah, Pokemon Go, I don't hear about it anymore, do you?
No. Isn't that crazy?
Gone. Here and gone.
It was the biggest thing ever for about 3 months, and now I don't even hear about it anymore.
Thank goodness.
Yeah.
Thank goodness. I'm ready to move on to the next topic.
Me too. So if we're going to go political a little bit, but outside of our realm a little bit, let's go Brexit.
Brexit, yes. The British exit from the European Union.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I hear a lot about how this, once again, is a trend. It's a wave of change that's taking place because of business as usual, politics as usual, that's been happening. So the Brexit is
the product of politicians and bureaucrats mistreating, if you will, or not taking good care of the responsibility that's been given them.
And so there was a lot of underhanded things that caused some of these European nations to join the European Union in the first place. Either they were given promises, they were made promises that weren't kept, or they were not told a lot of important information, and so they were just kind of lulled into this whole union of countries without good information or with misinformation. So the Britain voting against staying in the European Union is equated to the election of Donald Trump as president of the United States. So it's once again, it's a product of our changing times and that pendulum swing that has swung so far left for so long, and now it's coming back. And so that pendulum swing is scary, because you just wonder how far back it's going to come.
Right.
Yeah. So Brexit's interesting. It's one of the topics I don't know a whole lot about, but I know there's a lot of correlation between what's going on there in politics and what's going on here, because there's also a lot of rumors about other countries wanting to eject out of that union as well. You know, they're wanting to get out of there. It's like, you know, this isn't either what we thought it was, or y'all lied to us, didn't tell us what this was going to be.
Right.
Yeah, so interesting stuff, interesting times, but I'm cautiously optimistic for what's about to happen. But it could get pretty hairy, could get pretty dirty from here.
I can definitely see that.
Yeah.
So I don't know if you knew about this, but so remember the ice bucket challenge that happened, I'm guessing 2015?
Yeah, I remember that.
Okay, did you hear about the big breakthrough that actually came from that? Apparently they've found a huge breakthrough in ALS from the ice bucket challenge, from all the donations that was made through that actual situation.
No kidding. No, I didn't hear about that.
I didn't type down exactly what it is, but apparently there's a major, major breakthrough they've had with the gene that causes ALS.
Wow, that's huge.
Yeah,
that's crazy. ALS is that's a killer disease, like literally. Mm-hmm.
Did you do the ice bucket challenge by chance?
I didn't. I did the one before that though. What was that? Where you jumped into the water?
Are you sure that's not the ice bucket challenge?
No, it's not the ice bucket challenge, because the ice bucket is where you actually poured the bucket of ice water over the top.
Yeah, but I think it was
you.
All involved in the same thing, because.
No, I think maybe, before maybe not. No, before
what was
it was before it was the cold water challenge, I think.
Okay, maybe that's what I'm thinking
so,
of then.
Yeah, I know. We're you know, semantics here. We're splitting some hairs, but
okay.
No, because the cold water challenge, a lot of people were going in, and it was cold obviously, but they were going in and jumping into the lake or into the river or whatever. I myself jumped into a child's swimming pool.
Nice.
Yeah, that was, you know, it worked. It got the point across.
Yeah.
I feel like that I contributed to the cause. But the ice bucket challenge was where they actually There's some hilarious stuff that has gone on too,
yeah,
like with
is.
People standing on ladders and accidentally dropping this heavy cooler of ice onto somebody's head and causing a concussion. And since it didn't happen to me, it's funny.
I had a buddy of mine that was at work who I don't know what the piece of machinery was called, but it was one of the big pieces of machinery. They had a big bucket on the front of it, and he filled the bucket up with ice water and then jumped in. And then me and another buddy got together and went to a local spot and jumped off the cliff into the water. Had no idea how deep the water was, so I made him go first, just test it out. And it was so freaking cold. The second you hit the water, you couldn't breathe, and you were just swimming as fast as you could to get out of the water that you just couldn't breathe more. So it was like the whole time you're like, you know, just trying to catch your breath, but it was impossible.
Yeah, your body's going into shock.
It was insane. There was no reason I should have did it.
Yeah, you know, this whole thing is also it's a huge social media phenomenon, because that wouldn't have really happened, or it at least wouldn't have been effective without social media, you know,
right.
Because that's how you spread the word, and that's
right.
How you challenged other people. So
yep.
Social media to the rescue once again.
Okay, so let's go with Netflix added offline downloads.
I've heard about this, but I have not.
We just looked into it last weekend, I think.
Yeah,
because
this is brand new.
Yeah, it's really recent, but it may be just certain movies or certain shows that you can do it with, but you have to do like the new update for Netflix, and then once you go into it, it'll have like a little icon at the bottom that you can click, so you can actually watch them offline, which is pretty amazing.
So what do? Do you have to hook up an external hard drive, and then you download it into
that? I would imagine you can do that.
Because I know you can just go to it on a tablet.
I would imagine you can do that.
Yeah.
If not, it may just be like a Netflix library or something that like downloads to, do you know what I mean? Like,
I could see
where you can only access it through Netflix instead of being able to download to a hard drive. I'm not sure.
Well, I could see you being able to do that, you know, download it on a computer, but what about onto just like through the TV? You'd have to have something to store the data, right?
You would think.
Because you will be offline.
Right.
So, yeah, very good stuff, though. I love that. I love
Netflix. I
totally
should have done more research on that.
That's okay. We're just doing fly-by topics here, so it works. What else you got?
Star Wars The Force Awakens breaks
office record by passing $760.5 million.
Yeah, see, now, I'm not a Star Wars guy.
I have a lot of friends that are 100% major Star Wars guys. I'm not really.
Yeah.
I've got them just because I wanted to watch them before I went to watch The Force Awakens. And I got like through half a movie.
Yeah.
And I never went and watched it.
that's another one of those. I guess
that's one of the few that it kind of gets on my nerves because it is so huge and because people go around dressing up like, you know, Darth Maul.
Yeah,
or,
that's pretty over
the
top.
Yeah, all that cosplay that goes on. I think it's kind of goofy and I don't get it, but I try not to judge. I just try to stay away from it as much as possible. I'll never go see that movie.
Right. Let's go with record Powerball in U.S. at $1.6 billion.
That's insane.
Did you buy a ticket?
I didn't.
I did.
You did?
Didn't
did
win.
You win?
Apparently not. No. We're in my basement. Do you think does this look like a $1 billion house to you?
We're not on a private jet doing this show above, you know, Antigua.
A gold encrusted private jet.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, so, you know, I don't know. Lottery is what it is. Did somebody win that, I guess? Did you know who won it?
I think it was three people.
Three people?
Yeah, I think so.
Splitting $1.6 billion between three people ain't too bad.
That ain't too shabby.
For any of them.
Right.
But, yeah, I mean, I'm okay with the Powerball. It doesn't offend me in any way.
Right.
The odds of winning are insane. But I don't know. I mean, I kind of got conspiracy-minded there for a while because every time I saw the lottery is like this one old person after another. And like, I'm talking like 70, 80 years old. I'm like, okay, this is fixed because...
So you think they're just old and they're going to die before they can get all the money? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah,
so
either
it just
that,
goes back into the system?
Right. That's exactly right. Or when they die, you know, you got to pay death taxes in order to pass that money down as an inheritance. And so the government's just taking their chunks and they're just kind of guiding along to make sure that they're getting what's coming to them. You know, through the lottery commission or what have you. But, yeah, I was kind of conspiracy-minded when it comes to the lottery a little bit. But I have seen some younger people win. But, you know, I saw a pretty interesting show at some point, it might have been a couple of years ago, but it was about these people who won millions of dollars and are now broke. They blew through the whole thing, living, you know, in squalor now. And there was a lot of them, more times than not. There was this one lady who won multiple times, and she's still broke.
That's
insane. Yeah, she just keeps blowing the money, spinning it up, and I would like to have the chance to do that.
Right.
Know, but
right.
I don't know. Maybe I do right with my money. I don't know.
It's hard telling. I almost think that that's one of those things that you don't have any idea how you're going to react until the money's in front
of
you.
Yeah, true that. True that.
All right, so this one is near and dear to my heart and makes me extremely excited and extremely upset at the same time. We have Peyton Manning wins the Super Bowl, and then Peyton Manning retires.
Yeah.
So, I understand why you're upset. You're a big Peyton Manning fan.
Yes, sir.
I am, too. Not as big as you, I don't guess. But I like that he retired while he was on top, though.
I agree. I do agree.
And at his age, I mean, he had been pushing 40, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so it was time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was one of those comfortable, hey, I just won the Super Bowl. Let me retire before I get out there and tear something or, you know, make a lot of follies that are going to be on the highlight reel.
Right. And the thing about him is that I've always been a big fan of him, no matter, you know, for the longest time, ever since I can remember. But it's a matter of he was with the Colts. He went out with a neck injury, had four surgeries, tried to come back. Colts got rid of him. He went well, and this is after he had a Super Bowl win with the Colts. Colts got rid of him. He went to Denver, comes back, takes him to the Super Bowl the first year, loses, comes back the next year. He either broke his foot or he had plantar fasciitis, I think maybe what he had in his foot, but he was out for a part of the season with that too.
Wow.
And then comes back and wins the Super Bowl.
Yeah, the guy's a stud.
That's insane.
Yeah, he is. He's a... And on top of all that, he's also one of those likable guys, you know. He's not a jerk like Tom Brady, you know.
He's someone that can what's the word? Be for the brand, but he's a if you resemble the brand, what's the word I'm looking for?
A spokesman?
Yeah, I guess a spokesman for the brand, yeah. So he's a great spokesman for the NFL.
Yeah, he is. He is. And I think he has a good character.
Right.
And he's a good role model. You know, he's a good role model for the young people and whatnot. Because he's also funny.
Right.
He's been in several commercials where it's like, man, that guy's also funny.
If you haven't had a chance to watch the Comedy Central roast that he did recently. Have you seen that?
No.
Of, what's his name? I can't think of his name off the top of my head. But he did a Comedy Central roast not too long ago, and he murdered it. He was awesome in it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have to look it up. I can't remember.
Very funny guy. Super football player. The guy's amazing, especially overcoming all those obstacles like you just mentioned.
Right.
So give us one final topic, Cole.
One final.
What's the last one that we've got to work
with here? I got a couple.
Let
me pick one. Okay.
How about Bill Cosby is ordered to stand trial in a sexual assault case in Norristown?
Can you believe Bill Cosby?
No.
I mean, this guy for I don't know how many years, 30, 40, something like that, 50, who knows? It was a lot. He's one of those guys where you thought he was a role model. And then all of a sudden, these skeletons start coming out of the closet. And I don't know how most people thought about it, but when it first started coming out, I was like, no way.
I didn't believe it in the first place. And it was mainly because it was like one person that started the whole thing.
Yeah, right.
Okay. And the whole time I'm thinking, Bill Cosby's getting really up there in age. And this is just somebody wanting to take advantage of an older guy that has a lot of money.
Right.
Then you got another person coming out. Then you got another person coming out. And it's still, I was just like, this is just one person that's just taking advantage of what somebody else is taking advantage
of. Yeah, jumping on the bandwagon.
Right. And, you know, they're just trying to do it. Well, now we've got an ungodly amount of people or women who are coming out saying that they got Cosby-pilled.
Yeah.
If you want to call right. it.
They got Cosby'd.
They got Cosby'd.
I passed out and got Cosby'd.
Quaaludes, that's the word I was looking for.
Yeah, there you go.
They got quaaluded.
Yeah, I think that should be the new term in 2017 for sure. We rock out 2016 going to 2017, talking about people getting Cosby'd.
Yeah.
Cosby'd by Quaaludes.
There you go.
I mean, yeah, that's amazing because this guy, once again, he was a standard bearer for, especially for the African American middle class family. You know, the Huxtables, man, they were your go tos when you wanted to have someone to pattern your life from. With his sweaters and
like I said earlier, with Florence Henderson may have been the most beloved mother on TV ever, maybe, but I think Bill Cosby, up until all this happened, may have been the most beloved father, TV father out there.
Yeah, no doubt.
And I think that he broke the racial barrier as far as that goes too, because I don't think it was just I think he was a big influence in the white community as well, not just black.
Yeah, I think he was. I don't know if he was the first, but he was definitely one of the big actors, entertainers, who broke through that barrier and showed that an African-American man can reach to new heights and still be funny,
right,
and still have influence over the African-American people. You know, I don't think he was, I never heard him considered an Uncle Tom, you know, being that he was a white wannabe or whatever, you know, that he was domesticated however they put that. Because he was, but he was respected,
right.
You know, he broke through that glass ceiling that I guess most African Americans, if not all, up to that point felt like they were under, like they could only get so far, and then, you know, they couldn't reach a larger audience or that they couldn't be more successful or whatever. But I've seen interviews, I guess, on TV where some of the young actresses that were on the Cosby Show with him, he made them go to college. He says, if you want to continue being on this show, you have to go back to college. You have to finish college.
Wow.
If they were graduating, he basically forced them to get into college, to get an education.
Right.
That's how much of an impact that he had. And they did, you know, and it's something that they very well might not have done had it not been for Bill.
Right.
But what we didn't know was, you know, behind the scenes, he was, and it wasn't any of the cast members that he took advantage of, but somewhere out there he was Cosbying some females.
Right.
He was Quaaluding and Cosbying. So who would have known, right?
Right. So what do you think, man? I mean, to put just this year, 2016, into a bubble, how would you describe it in your terms?
Well, you know, it's been a crazy year, but most years are crazy to some degree or another. I think that election years always have the potential to be a circus, you know, and this one was definitely a circus, and I think it's going to be a circus that resonates throughout the years to come. But I look forward to 2017. Let me kind of cascade into what I feel like is in the future, because I don't feel like there's anywhere to go but in circles right now through 2017, and it's because of what's going on in 2016, with the election and with the Brexit and with just the things that have been highlighted, like the act itself of Harambe getting shot. I don't think was that big of a deal. I think it's the response of people that is something to watch. I think that's the interesting thing.
Right.
And so I'm looking forward to how that transpires in our next year, and being able to reflect back on some of the things that 2016 started for us, you know. How about you?
I agree. I think that the majority of every good thing or bad thing that's happened in 2016 is all a culmination of reactions from everybody,
mm-hmm.
how everybody decided that they wanted to take it. And then anybody who didn't have a firm belief or decision on anything that happened, they just rode the wave off of other people.
Yeah.
And don't necessarily think that's the way to go. I think that just like we tried to put out with this podcast, I think people need to learn to think for themselves. They need to unhook from the matrix, and they really need to, just think about everything in depth before they make a firm decision for themselves.
Word.
And I think that's one of the best ways to make 2017 a better year than this one.
Yep. Couldn't have said it better myself, man. Let's hopefully get the word out there to to start using our brains, man, and use some critical thinking and stop going with these crazy reactions, you know, and stop getting into this mob mentality and start getting into more of a thought provoking, you know, realistic, critically thought process of human evolution, you know, and start making this world a better place and stop fomenting on the past.
Right. Well, everybody has New Year's resolutions, right? So yeah. we're a week away from that.
Yeah. All right.
And I think that regardless of if people listen to it or not, this podcast is here to stay. So I think we're going to do everything we can to make people think for themselves and
give our opinions out there, and hopefully people listen to it and take it at will.
Yep, let's do it.
Sounds good.
All right.